Hi everyone, this is Ghalib Kamal and you are seeing me on my YouTube channel. And today I have a very special person with me. He's from India and basically he was involved with the Tabligh movement for a very long time and he is aware with the ins and outs of this Tabligh movement. Today's video is basically in English because Hassan actually speaks Tamil and I cannot speak Tamil. So we are going to communicate in English and he's going to tell us about the current crisis through which the Indian government and the people who run the Tabligh movement are going through, because it is kind of becoming a very non-cooperation type of environment in which the leaders of the Tabligh movement or the overall members of the Tabligh movement are not cooperating with the Indian government on the level which is required to control this outbreak of coronavirus in India. So Hassan, I would like to welcome you on my channel. And I know that the people who are watching my channel would very much like to listen to what you have to say about the current situation and the role of the Tabligh movement in it.
Yeah, thank you, Ghalib, to inviting me to your discussion. And thanks everyone and for your viewers as well. And let's move on. I'm moving on with the discussion. Yes.
So currently, as you are seeing that coronavirus is wreaking havoc all over the world, and globally, it has become a cause of concern for even those countries where it has not hit that bad as it has hit bad in Europe or in America. So what do you think, how this thing is going to progress in India and how the Tabligh movement is kind of becoming a problem, and what they think about this?
I think Tabligh movement, let's get into the details of the Tabligh movement itself in detail later. But as you asked the question itself, how this is going to be a problem in coming weeks and months in India, I think it's going to be very huge. I think this is going to be like patient 31 10x. I mean, happened in South Africa, this is the case, exact scenario is going to be unfolding right in front of our eyes in India right now. So this is all I can say at the moment. So I hope we'll be able to make it under control, but as of now seems like it is getting out of hand at the moment, because this seems like these people have already spread across the country and spread all over the world also to many other countries as well. Yeah, that's with regard to I think what we heard in the news is continuously these Tablighi, the seniors were warned by the Delhi police and other authorities, and they're not being taken very seriously. And even the Delhi police has released the video subsequently, because the Tablighi seniors have tried to shift the blame onto the Delhi police, saying this the Delhi police has not taken this issue seriously, and they have taken this very lightly, even though they have asked to evacuate the attendees. Tablighi markers. Yeah. So they have tried to shift the blame onto the Delhi police and the other government officials. So then the Delhi police has released the video, which has happened somewhere around 23rd or somewhere. They have called up some senior six officials, Tablighi seniors, and they have warned to evacuate these markers as soon as possible. So they have tried to shift the blame onto the government itself, unfortunately.
So the Tablighi leaders are not cooperating. They are not willing to evacuate the markers.
It seems like that is what has been happening. They have been dragging their feet all along and they have not been taken seriously. And but I have heard even from this, what I got the tape, actually what was released in the media, I got the Tamil translation of it, and I think I can assure you that the accuracy of it is almost similar. But he, the Maulana says, the Maulana Saad, what he says in Urdu and the Tamil translation is almost identical. What he says very clearly is that this is the time to not to move away from the mosque. This is the time to get closer to the mosque. So it is obviously, this is this itself is a direct violation of the rules and regulation as put in place about this social distancing and all the rest of it. So that itself,
So I want to ask you, what will happen if these people continue to pray five times a day in the mosque, and they also continue to a huge number of people also continue to gather on every Friday for the Jummah prayer? So what do you think, how the virus is going to spread? Because, you know, person to person contact and a lot of people coming together in a close vicinity is going to transmit the virus. And what do you think, their students and the people who come to say prayer in the mosque, aren't they going to get sick?
Obviously, I mean, they are also well aware about it. In the same audio, the Maulana says, is referring to some, you know, the certain quoting from the history where the Sahabas, and during the Sahabas time, this kind of pandemics had hit, and the one Sahaba who led the prayers, and, you know, during one prayer, the then he died, and the following prayer, his funeral prayer was done. You know, so this is for them, this is the like dying in the path of it's like a jihad for them, you know, dying in
it's
the
a test of their faith.
The highest is kind of not only the test of their faith, it's kind of a martyrdom, you know, it's like the highest reward for them to die as a
So they, like, they know the, these Maulanas,
they are fully, they are fully aware about what is going to happen.
So
they are fully aware about it. They are not ignorant of what is going to happen.
So you mean to say that the leading Maulanas are exactly aware that what coronavirus or this COVID-19 disease is going to do to the Muslim people who are coming to their mosque to attend? So are they communicating this danger to the people who are coming to attend the mosque, or they are just keeping them in oblivion? What do you think?
If you're talking about it, then I have to go into detail about the whole, how this whole Tablighi movement operates.
We would like to learn
talk
about that.
So this is not about, if I am to start from the beginning, if I am just to give an introduction about this whole Tablighi, I actually, it's not a more than a Jamaat is, I mean, it's a group basically, right? But it's not a group, it's more than a group. I would like to call it, since I've been in this movement for like nearly two decades in this movement, and fortunately I was able to open up my eyes and see the reality. It's basically, I would like to say this is a cult, nothing less than a cult. Because if you look all the characteristic of a cult, this movement has all the characteristics. So these people, all these Tablighi followers, they blindly follow whatever the leadership says. Even even they don't, they call themselves Muslims, or the, if more than that, for them, even they will disregard what is in the, even what is in the Quran or Hadith even. Even if the leadership says something, that is what they will follow, not what is in the Quran or Hadith. So this is basically a cult, cult following. If you see their activities, they dress alike, they eat alike, and this is how they behave. So that is out their control, and they are like, even I don't know how many aware, and even about this movement, even most majority Muslims are not aware about what is going inside this movement. Even so, the Muslim scholars themselves, even majority of the Muslim scholars themselves don't know what is going inside this movement. They are also basically ignorant. Actually, it operates in a very, very subtle way, because these movement, they don't keep anything in black and white. They don't keep anything in writing. Okay.
That's really strange.
If you walk into any Tablighi markers, even in Tamil Nadu or wherever you find them, they have a very strong leadership from Tamil Nadu, and the regional wise, area wise, even a mosque as a Hamir, you know, they have broken down leadership, but nothing in writing. If you walk into a markaz, it will look very similar to a normal mosque. You won't find anything.
So that who is coming in and who is going out? They don't keep any kind of record. So in this case, if someone wants
maybe you will find a piece of paper in someone's pocket. That's all you will find.
So even if they have traveled to different countries and brought back coronavirus with them, so you wouldn't find any history, any travel history, that who is going where and which Tablighi member is coming from which country. So you wouldn't find anything.
But the strange thing is, they are very smart enough to they have very close connection. They have the personal connection.
So do you think they might even be trying to hide the people, or trying to give protection to these people who have traveled abroad and come from abroad?
Exactly. If you really know the how they operate, it's very easy for them to hide, Ghalib. So for example, if I am to tell you how they recruit and how they, it is too much of a detail to tell you how they recruit and how they get membership. There's no membership as such, because it's a very, very loose movement. They don't give any membership card or anything like that. So it's a very, very strange movement in that sense. So, but you know, like, they have something called very stringent regiment, you know, the rituals, you know, what you have to follow daily, weekly, monthly, yearly.
Okay.
You know,
so
like what you have
in a
to
sense
do
you can at, say yeah in a sense yeah. you can say that they are like some kind of gangs that exist in the West. You can equate them with them, like racist gangs.
not only like a gang, it's like a cult.
Yeah, because many gangs also have their own cult.
But I would say this is the most successful cult, operates subtly, I mean, blinding everyone's eyes in a very subtle way all over the world.
So do you think that this resistance, the kind of resistance they are showing towards closing the mosques, do you think that this resistance is going to continue in the future, even when people will start to drop like the flies? Do you think like
even
this?
Even if they die, start falling dead, I mean, that is not going to scare them. So, as I told, this is not going to scare them. This is what they believe. For them, this is the Shaheed, the higher status for them. This is what they've been fed throughout. They will quote from the Sahaba. This is how the Sahabas died, you know. So
for normal people like us, it's death. Yeah. But for them, it's martyrdom. So they are going to bring it upon themselves, and along with them, normal people like us
That is the real danger. They are going to spread it to others as well. Yeah, that is the real
So
danger
in
here.
such a situation, would you support the government to take, if the government takes a strict or a harsh action against these people?
Exactly, exactly. Here, with these people, normal negotiation, discussion is not going to work because these people are totally resistant to any logical reasoning. So only stringent regulation, strict hard action is going to work with these people. So we'll have to learn it the hard way. If not, we'll have to pay a very higher price in that case with the people's
okay.
lives.
And
yeah.
and let's talk about a normal tablighi, a person
yeah.
who is not a leader, who is just a member. Maybe he is not very well educated. He has just got nominal education and he doesn't have
yes.
a very good understanding of biology or medicine or science. So do
yeah.
you think if even someone tries to educate such a person who is just a normal
yeah.
tablighi, will it work on
yeah.
these people or not?
Absolutely.
Like,
not.
let's say you or I, we go to the tablighi markaz and or we meet such
yeah.
a tablighi and we try to tell him
yeah.
about coronavirus or COVID-19 disease and how it spreads.
No.
So will we be able to make these people understand?
No, you won't be able to, because they will say for them it is you know for them, even for that matter, even an average Muslim, you know, will say this is this has come from God, Allah, you know, and this is
uh-huh.
a punishment or a test. So this is nothing to do with biology for them, you know. It is only a suburb for them. The virus is a suburb, only a means of Allah is testing you. So this is a direct punishment for our sins or whatever. So no amount of science, no amount of rational explanation is going to convince them
one
of
other
the
thing
danger.
You might be seeing for the last few days on social media and even on mainstream media, it is playing now, even in Pakistan, which is my country,
yeah.
in India, and even
yeah.
from Bangladesh, I've seen some videos. There are Maulavis who are praying for the West and the non-Muslim countries to be destroyed by this coronavirus. So do you think even the people of this Tablighi Jamaat might be saying the same prayers, or they might
I
also
think,
be wishing that?
They are the biggest initiator of all these prayers, to my knowledge. They are the people, if I'm not mistaken, today most of the people were fasting
mm-hmm.
in the Southeast Asia. I don't know about the rest of the world. So it is these Tablighis are the main instigators of all these fasting and praying and repentance and all the rest of it. They think, I mean, I'm getting so many audios, you know, because I am a prosecuted Muslim. So I am still
mm-hmm.
have connection with these Tablighis and so many other Muslim groups. So I'm in and out, I'm getting all these messages throughout. So what they're saying is only way of getting rid of this virus is through our repentance, nothing else. No amount of scientific research or medicine is going to work for this. Only our good deeds will bring us a solution for this. So this is their thinking.
So
yeah.
I don't know if you are aware, there was a Maulvi in Pakistan. His name is Naimi,
yeah.
Maulana Naimi. So at first he was saying
yeah.
all these similar things, that this coronavirus is not going to
yeah.
do anything. This is a hoax or a conspiracy
yeah.
by the West. And
yeah.
in the end, he was infected by it, and he had to also being, he was also admitted in the hospital, and he was on a ventilator for a week or so then. But thankfully this guy survived. So
yeah.
these people, but when it comes to dying, do you think these people will go to the hospitals to be treated, or there could be a small minority as well who wouldn't even want to be treated?
Yeah, there'll be, it's possible, so small minority, they don't want to be treated as well. I can understand that mentality as well, because they would rather die than accept the reality. There's a percentage of these hardcore fanatics. They would rather die than, you know, think through and accept the reality. I can very well understand that. Since I have been with these people, yeah.
So, do you think that government should charge these leaders of this movement
definitely.
For
of
crime
course,
of spreading
to.
A
they
disease?
Have to.
They should.
Definitely, they have to charge. They have to charge not only the leadership, even at the regional level. Whoever been, I should say something, Ghalib. One more thing. Which has been happening throughout with regard to this Nizamuddin Markaz. All these decades, for decades and decades, this has been happening with regard to Nizamuddin Markaz. People have been visiting this Markaz all over the world. This is the Tablighi headquarters, world headquarters.
Yeah, exactly. Worldwide headquarters. Yeah.
Worldwide headquarters. You know, even I have been there. So, like, people from all over the world visit on the tourist visa. So that itself is, violating the visa regulations.
Yeah, because the religious missionary visa is a different visa.
Different visa, exactly. But actually, there is turn a blind eye to this issue simply because, these people act very benign, you know.
Uh-huh.
They and therefore they think these people are very. If you outward these people look very spiritual kind of people, non-threatening, non-violent kind of a people. So the authorities, mistakenly think these people are not going to be a threat, but actually these people are the springboard for all the other terrorist organizations. These people are the kind of fuel. Actually, if you I can give you the details where this it is the Tablighis who have gone and joined even the Taliban and all the other Pakistani terrorist outfits. So it is this Tablighi movement which gives the initial impetus for all these terrorist organizations. So these people,
yeah, even in
told,
Pakistan, I could say the same for them in Pakistan as well, because
yeah,
the, from
yeah,
the Tablighi
yeah,
movement
yeah.
is connected with the Jihad movement, and Jihad movement is connected with Kashmir Jihad, and then the Taliban Jihad in Afghanistan.
Exactly. So the authorities are really confused. So they confuse even the average Muslim is kind of in confusion who these people are. So just imagine a non-Muslim trying to figure it out who these people are. So it could be impossible task for them to find out who these people really are.
So do you think that these people? How do you explain like? Do you think that these people really hate non-Muslims, like non-Muslims living in India, or?
No, it's not. It's not a hate. Actually, these people, their mission, their life mission is to emulate the 7th century Arabian lifestyle. They think the 7th century Arabian lifestyle is the perfect one to live.
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
So, when people become indoctrinated with all the beliefs that come from the Tabligh movement, so is there an element of hate that was maybe already present in a Muslim person? Does it become aggravated? Does it increase in some way during this getting joined or being a part of this Tabligh movement? Do you think?
Yeah,
like the overall kind.
Yeah, it is an hatred, but the Tablighis are really a smart people. Unlike they are not vocal about their hatred like any other jihadi or even like Jamaat Islami or anything like that. They don't. You won't see Tablighis go on protest march, holding placards or shouting slogans or anything like that. They are very peaceful outwardly, as I told. That's why they are very, even the officials are very fond of these people, So they don't get into any political activities or anything like that even. But the hatred is very subtle. They are only, as I told, the life mission is to, they wait for the time, the right time. where they can establish the Sharia or the Khilafat. So they are waiting for the right time where they can get that critical mass. They are trying to convince the enough Muslims that Islam is the right solution. Then they will get activated. So
okay.
this is
One other
their
thing.
thinking.
One
Yes.
other thing, like as compared to Jamaat-e-Islami in India, what do you think? Is Jamaat-e-Islami more influential or they are more influential among
I
the
would
Muslim
say
masses?
The I think both are influential in different ways. Actually, Jamaat-e-Islam works top to bottom, and Tablighi works from bottom to top. You know, Jamaat-e-Islam believes in establishing the Sharia first and convincing the people. Tablighi believes in convincing the people first, the importance of the Sharia first, and then establishing the Sharia.
Okay.
So,
so one other question that I have.
Please
explain, then I will ask that one.
Yeah, then in the end, the both the Jamaat-Islam or even the Tablighi or even the Salafi or any other movements, their objective is the same, to establish the Sharia or the Khilafah in the end. But their means and their mode of operation is different. This is the only difference. But the real objective is in the end to establish the Sharia, they establish the Khilafah.
So I will ask a hypothetical question here. Like, let's say the Tabligh movement decides to come on the government side in this crisis, and they want to tell the people to observe all the sanctions that are being put by the government or all the precautions that the government is advising. So
I
if
think,
the Tabligh movement...
I think that's kind of a tactical withdrawal. They are already, I think what I heard in the news already, I think already the Maulana, I don't know whether it's the authentic one, has already released an audio saying his followers is kind of a basically kind of a U-turn of what he has said only a week ago. Is saying basically to follow the government regulation. So the Tablighis are very, very, very much used to this kind of tactical withdrawals. So actually, there's a word called, it's almost like a takia, you know, like a very, they call it the hikmah, the hikmah.
Yeah, where they lie according to the situation.
Yes, exactly.
That
but
the situation does
they
not
are
harm
the
them.
Most, exactly. These people are the most subtlest group of people you will find among the Muslims. So that's why they go undetected. I can tell you, even I can even share with you some documents, even they have gone undetected, even to the CIA. So they have been that smart.
Okay. So if they come on board with the government and they start telling the people that they have, that the people have to comply with the instructions of the government. So do you think in that sense, in that situation, when they are on the same, on the same standing with the government, the Muslims in India are going to cooperate with the government? If there is, let's say, Maulana Saad issues a public statement saying that every Muslim has to cooperate with the government. So do you think it can improve the situation, or it can
it's
totally dissolve the situation?
I think his followers, the Tablighis, I think if I'm maybe like around 20 to 30% of the population, will definitely follow his instructions, definitely.
Okay, so these people, if they want to, they can have a good impact, but they wouldn't do that. So, but one thing that we are seeing a lot of resistance from the Indian Muslims when it comes to closing the mosque or not saying prayers in the mosque. There have been people who have been saying prayers secretly in the mosques. There have been even if the government is not allowing for the Jummah prayers, and there have been a lot of raids, which and a lot of videos have come in front of us where the police has raided the mosques, and they have seen large gatherings in secret in the mosques. So where does, can you see this? Do you feel that this behavior is going to change, or it's not going to change? Let's say after a month, there are a lot of deaths in India and even in the Muslim community. So is this behavior then going to change when they see someone dying in front of them,
no,
or some of their relatives or
it's
neighbors
not
die?
No, No, I doubt it. I doubt it very much. It's going to change. The more they say, see, the more they're going to get, get into their mosque and get into their mosque and do this thing more. All I can see that they're not
So
never going to get away from it.
then this means that then we have a very terrible future is awaiting India or maybe even Pakistan, because
Exactly,
this
exactly. I think
very
that
influential group of people is not going to let people follow
Yeah,
the path that the government tells them to follow.
as per one study, Ghalib, as per one study, because these people don't keep any, as I told, anything in black and white. Though in overall, these groups, Tablighi influence overall, is been. Is diminishing, but still their membership, kind of is in the region of like 100 million, I should say, worldwide. They're operating
So
all yeah in the world around almost 200 odd countries. As you can see, these people are in even in Andaman and Nicobar Island. You can see that. So yeah.
So before we end this, Hassan, would you
Yes.
like to give some kind of advice to the Indian Muslims or even the Pakistani Muslims and the governments of both the countries, provided the current crisis that we are facing, what the Muslims should do and what the government should do to make the Muslims cooperate with the government in case of India especially?
Yeah, I would like to say as a finishing note, this is a very serious situation. I mean, it is this virus does not discriminate among faith communities or even regional borders or whatever, right?
Yeah,
So we
exactly.
have
It's
to
a very
take it.
secular
I think
virus.
the exactly.
It's
So
exactly.
it's a very secular virus. So exactly. So I think that it is the Indian government or the Pakistani government, for that matter, should take this very seriously and take into their hands and to put these people in place, because these people are a group of people are never going to. You can never convince these people by discussion. So this is you have to take some stern action, what was taken in China, for example. That's how you can control this virus. This is not the time to be nice to these people. So, but I think the Muslim community itself, I think those who are educated, those who are in the middle class, will people like hopefully those who are moderate Muslim will come to realize. The gravity of the situation, and will take a fresh look about their faith and how to be the moderate Muslims and not be a burden to their community, not to be a burden to their country. That is my only hope, and be a worthwhile citizen.
Yeah, exactly. So thank you very much, Hassan, for being with us and for the
Okay,
people
Ali,
who are
thank you very much
watching.
to as well. It's a pleasure talking to you as well, Ali,
Yeah,
and
it
inviting me.
has been a very brave on Hassan's part. He is a closet ex-Muslim. He doesn't reveal his non-belief to his family even, and he has been living in secret. And so are many other ex-Muslims who cannot reveal their identities or their beliefs to even their family members. So it's a difficult situation, but it is a very courageous thing on his part to come and tell us about what is going on and what is the true psychology of these people. So I will see you in another video with a different topic. So we are going to sign out now. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe and click the bell icon to receive all the notifications. You can also support me on Patreon. The link to Patreon is in the description. If you help me on Patreon, it will be much easier for me to continue my work and spread this message to a greater number of people.